Ooh, y'all are quiet. Get ready. You ready? Ready? Good morning!
Good morning!
Great. Y'all do great when I prepare you. It's good to see y'all this morning. It's good to be back. I would like to say that we had an awesome trip. And awesome is capitalized. Okay? We had a great trip. We would like to thank all of you who helped us with your funds and with your prayers. Oh, it was just great. And at the end of July, we're going to present to you and show you all the pictures and tell you of all the stories and the great things that we did and the fun that we had. So just pat yourselves on the back because y'all did a great job helping us out, and we had so much fun. So let's get started with the service today. I already said my good mornings. So now, let me welcome all of you visitors. And I see some visitors. Wow, have y'all grown? The Davidsons. Wow. Okay, I'm in a little bit of shock right now. Woo! Goodness gracious. Okay, hey, y'all. And I see some other familiar faces, and I see some unfamiliar faces. So if you are a visitor, fill out the flappy sheet of paper in your bulletin and rip it out and put it in the offering plate in a few minutes. Just want to have a record of your visit. Now, open your bulletins. Whoa, there's a lot of stuff written down in here. And I don't have all the time to go over it. So that means you're going to have to read it. Okay? We don't want to pop quiz next Sunday morning. But something that's not in the bulletin is youth snacks. I have a few. I think I have two more for the summer that I need to be filled. And actually, one is next Sunday night. So if any of you have the courage and brave enough to put your name down on this list for next Sunday night, please come and see me after church. And then I have another one in July. So please come and see me. If you have a pool, that would be great. If you don't, that's fine. If you have food, that's definitely good. So please, come and sign up. And just let me highlight some things here. We got a meeting going on, the cemetery trustees, children's ministry fundraiser. I think they have an announcement to make. Come on, children.
The Children's Ministry Committee is selling Williams t-shirts to raise money for Passport Kids. The cost is $12. Passport Kids campers will be stationed at church exits to take orders today.
You may also place orders and give them to Mary Oliver or Wendy Ponder. Youth and adult sizes are available along with several color choices. Please pay when you place your order. Thanks in advance for your support of our children.
Ooh, those models are handsome. Good job, guys. And those shirts are just too cute. Y'all need to grab one. There's some things going on today. It's like a special day. Let me think. Father's Day. Hey, fathers. If your father's here, find him and smile at him. My dad, he's not here today. But I have a lot of others I could count as a father. We love you, men. We love you, fathers. We're going to recognize you later. And also, it's Youth Sunday, which means we have a few youth that move up to replace those, well, not replace them, but take the spot, sort of, those who graduated out, which is sad. But we'll recognize those later. But also, the youth are going to be taking part in the service today in many ways, so you will see that. And we also have a guest speaker this morning, and she is over here, Michelle Thomas. She will be doing the sermon this morning. So please pray for her throughout the service. So I've done enough talking. So I want you to stand up and find someone to hug, kiss on the cheek, shake hands, whatever you want to do. Go for it.
Thank you. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity. 1 Timothy 4:12.
Singing page 202, so if y'all would stand, please.
Thank you.
If y'all would turn with me to page 563.
This past week at camp, we gave to and collected an offering that would aid in the ministry of Sam and Latha Bandela. The Bandelas work with CBF to reach unreached and unevangelized people groups in India with special focus on North India. Sam and Latha have helped tsunami survivors with life skills programs such as sewing centers and other community projects, including distribution of fishing nets, school uniforms, and Bibles.
Pray for the Bandela's mission and vision to enlist, encourage, educate, equip, enable, and empower Indian nationals for evangelism and church planting in India. Please bow your heads for a time of silent prayer. Amen.
Okay, like I said earlier, it is Youth Sunday, and we have a few youth moving up. If you look in your bulletin on the insert, in the back of that insert, there's the list of those that are moving up. Now, a few of them are visiting their fathers this weekend, and some are at the beach. So I just have a few here, and I would like for them to come up, which I believe I have Abby Hedgepath. She come on up. Drew Lewiski and Samuel Oliver. Come on down.
Well, I just wanted you to see their faces. I'll see them around with us now. And I want them just to tell something about themselves. Maybe like one of their hobbies. This is Abby Hedgepath. We are so excited. I'm so excited to have her back. I've got to hang out with these kids, actually, at elementary school, so I've been so excited. Anyway, And there were four of the kids that went with us, the youth. And did y'all have fun? We had so much fun with them. But Drew, tell us about yourself. He really likes sports. You know him now. And this is Samuel Oliver. I don't know, he might look familiar to you. He's a preacher's kid. And Samuel, tell us about yourself.
I love to play basketball, and I love watching y'all play football.
Yeah. We'll have to switch over sometimes to Auburn and North Bay, sorry. But anyways, this is just a few of our huge group that's moving up, and I'm so excited. I want y'all to know that the youth are excited too, and we love you so very much. We have a gift for you that we're going to give in just a minute. But first, we're going to have a little blessing, a little prayer, and I'm going to ask Will Haney to do that. So he's going to come up and pray for y'all. It's a long walk, isn't it? And Will also went to camp with us.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the great experience we had last week at Passport. Thank you for Nikki and the positive influence she has on our youth group. Lord, please be with our new members moving up so that they feel welcome and know that they are an important part of our church. Help us encourage them and be good examples to them as they move up. Amen.
He's a very quiet person, but he is the greatest dad in the world to me. And he always provides everything for me, and he always makes me laugh.
My dad is just a great person all around. I love hanging out with him, going hunting with him sometimes. I don't go all the time.
What do y'all like about y'all's dad?
He plays games with
me. He does. Anybody else?
He talks to me when I'm like in trouble or something.
Anyone else?
He loves me.
He loves you?
Yes.
Well, today we're going to recognize our dad, so if I could get all the dads to stand up. And we're going to pass out a few lifesavers. And could y'all help me pass them out?
All you fathers, please stand.
Some in the choir, guys. Got some in the choir. Cool. back up. I know this is Father's Day, but this is a special day in the life of one of our women in our church. Audrey Freeman, happy birthday to you.
Okay, we will be singing 404, and would y'all please stand up with me? First, second, and third verse. First, second, fourth verse.
Oh, well. So glad you're here today. This is a very special day, Father's Day, and also Youth Sunday. We're very proud of our youth in our church, aren't we? And our group is, I think, very well represents our Lord and our church, wherever they go, whatever they do. I appreciate all of them taking advantage of the opportunity to lead in our service today. It's a great way for them to learn because they will be our future leaders in our congregation. So they have to have this opportunity periodically to do that. I know it's not always easy, but I appreciate y'all volunteering or being willing at least to be available to lead in all aspects of our service this morning. I wanted to say I was very proud of our youth and our camp. I think we had 23 kids who went. I kept up with just one group, the boys. So we found interesting things like opening a refrigerator and the freezer and finding a frozen roll of toilet paper with underwear sticking out of the top. I think that was a prank that was passed on from Taylor and Cody and Jake and probably before that, Robbie Quinn and others, I don't know. So your legacy, you know, lives on. There were some mattress sliding down the stairwell, I think, in the girls' side. We didn't do that in the boys' side. Anyway, we had a great time. They did a lot of hard work and reached a lot of people for Christ, provided an outstanding witness. In fact, we talked on Thursday night about some of the places we went into that were terrible. Terrible places to live and to be, and very thankful that our kids are not there. But there are people who live in situations that are dangerous, and they went to those places. And somebody said, well, we were looking to see where is God in that place. And I commented that I felt like that when we walked in that we were the light that those folks needed to see that day. So we brought Christ there in that sense. We were the presence of Christ in that place. So I was proud of our youth, wherever they went and what they did this week. Hopefully we'll get to hear fuller stories about their experiences at camp. But thank y'all for providing us the funds in order to do that. Many of you contribute through our church budget, and that allows us to have an ongoing comprehensive youth ministry. But also a lot of you gave stock. You invested in the lives of our young people this summer, and it allowed them the opportunity to have experiences like they had. There were a lot of them, but Thursday night, which is our last night together, we have a group devotion. And year in and year out, this was no exception, that is a night that I would not miss for anything in the world. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience of solidarity among our youth, and I was really proud of the way I could sense the Holy Spirit working in their lives. Hopefully we will continue to see that in a lot of ways through our church, but I wanted to thank y'all for praying for us and helping us to be able to go to camp and have that experience. Several weeks ago, maybe months ago, I asked one of our youth on Youth Sunday if she would preach and bring the message, and that was Michelle Thomas. Michelle's a person I've seen literally grow up in our church from a little girl, baptized her. I've seen her grow physically, mentally, and spiritually, and not everybody avails the opportunity to get up and preach on Youth Sunday. Whenever I ask youth to do that, I know it can be a scary thing, but I think Michelle has a word from the Lord to share with us this morning. She is a leader at our school here, in our church, and she is a leader in our youth ministry, and I know she's going to do a great job today. I'm very excited to hear what the Lord's laid on your heart, Michelle, and thank you for making yourself available this morning. We will be praying for you, but we're excited to hear what God has to say for you today. Okay? God bless you. We'll come in a moment as soon as we have our scripture read.
The scripture today comes from Hebrews 11:1. Faith means being sure of the things we hope for and knowing that something is real even if we don't see it.
Taught the sun where to stand in the morning? Who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose word eyes alone can catch a falling star.
Thank you, Rhonda. That was really good. Well, good morning, everybody. No, not used to seeing me up here. You're seeing Mike. But, Mike asked me about, I don't know how many months ago, but it was at the Valentine's Day banquet. And he said, you know, Youth Sunday's coming up, and it's going to be on Father's Day. I was like, okay, I didn't know that. And he said, you thought about what you're going to do? And I was like, no, I'm just going to wait on Nikki to tell me what to do. And then he said, would you do the preaching? And then I was like, You know, I kind of had, the only way I can describe it is what I call Moses syndrome. Whenever God asked him to lead his people out of Egypt, he was like, not me. That's what I was thinking. I was like, not me. You must have the wrong room. You might want somebody in the next room because it ain't me. And but before I told him no, it's like I had a peace over me, and it's like God told me, you know, I won't let you fail. So reluctantly, I was like, okay, God, you know what you're doing. I don't, you know, you're going to have to help me with this. But I was like, yes, I'll do it. So now I stand before you fine people today, and I think I changed my sermon 800 times. I started on one thing, then I was like, no. And I was reading in my devotion that my dad got me for Christmas, and it was talking about faith, and I was like, that is it. That is what I'm missing. This is what I need. And so I was looking through a couple of Bibles, trying to find the version that I liked, and the one that I actually found was from the New Century Version of Hebrews 11:1. And it's Jesse Kate read, thank you. It says, faith means being sure of the things we hope for and knowing that something is real, even if we do not see it. And I thought, you know, how true was that? How true? And one of my favorite movies, A Walk to Remember, the two main characters are talking about faith in it. And I like the way she puts it. She says, it's like the wind. You can't see it, but you can feel it, and you know it's there. And I said to myself, I said, that's it. That's right, you know, because you can't always see Jesus, but you know he's there. He's like the air or the wind. He's always going to be with you no matter what. So I thought, how can I put this into words about how I want to describe this? So I thought, what if somebody came up to you as you're walking down the street and said, hey, what's faith? What is that all about? And so the way I can describe it is, he is what wakes me up in the morning. You know, he is the strength I have to get up every day, and I know I'm not alone, that no matter what life throws at me, somebody's always going to be with me, and it's Jesus. And so I thought, you know, he's going to laugh with me on the good days. He's going to love with me on the really good days. And he's going to provide comfort with me when the bad days come, when I'm sad. And he's going to protect me when I get really, really frightened. So it's that blessed assurance, you can call it. And one of my favorite poems, The Footprints, I think everybody is pretty familiar with that one. It's one of my favorites. I like the last line of it. Whenever Jesus is talking to the man, he says, the times when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. And that means to me, you know, whenever it gets bad, and like the man in the poem thought, you know, Jesus, why are you going to abandon me? He didn't. He was carrying him the whole way. So I think that says a lot about faith right there. You know, you got to have that strength to go on and to know that he's with you. And he believes in us, and he just wants us to believe in him as much as he does. And so then I thought, you know, what's another question that some random person might ask me, you know? Thought about, what if they said, how can one have faith? What's the key? You know, what is to gain by having faith? And I just thought, you know, it's really just knowing you are never alone and that God loves you unconditionally and irrevocably. That's what I thought. And to know that your salvation can never be taken away from you, I thought was another big key to me. And that's what speaks to me whenever I think, you know, somebody asked me what's the key and what's to gain by faith, that's what I thought. Whenever you accept Jesus into your heart and you know that he's with you always and forever. And as I got to looking in my devotion one night, and I was saying, okay, God, come on, give me something. I need something today to figure out what am I going to do, because I'm really terrified of getting stage fright in front of everybody. So I wanted to read you one of the pages that I read, and I was like, I'm going to use that. It's called Not Guilty. And it says, every moment of your life, your accuser is filing charges against you. He has noticed every error and marked each slip. Try to forget your past, he'll remind you. Try to undo your mistakes, he'll thwart you. This expert witness has no higher goal than to take you to court and press charges. Who is he? The devil. He rails, this one you call your child, God, he is not worthy. As he speaks, you hang your head. You have no defense. His charges are fair. I plead guilty, Your Honor, you mumble. The sentence, Satan asks, the wages of sin is death, explains the judge. But in this case, the death has already occurred, for this one died with Christ. Satan is suddenly silent, and you are suddenly jubilant. You have stood before the judge and heard him declare, not guilty. And personally, I think what stops most people from either experiencing Jesus or having faith is that sense of unworthiness. You know, like, who am I to deserve someone to send their son to die for me? You know, when I've done all this bad stuff in my life, and I know that it was bad, and I know that it was wrong, who am I to deserve that kind of love? And I think that is something that, you know, stops a lot of people, and I think it is our job to tell them, you know, that everything is going to be okay. And I think everyone wants to hear those words of Matthew 25:23, well done, good and faithful servant, because personally that's what I want to hear. And being a servant is part of faith. It's all about trusting God when he calls you to do something in his name. And what I learned this week at camp is that we have a good youth group. And, you know, there were some problems with some of the other youth groups, some disciplinary problems, and I was like, how good is our church to have raised up good kids to where we never have to be, like, got on to or be sent home for something wrong? And I just want to commend our youth group and our college and career for being those good kids. And I remember Nikki always telling us, you know, I'm supposed to tell you this, but I know I don't have to. And she would explain some disciplinary action, and I was like, you know, that's good that she has to say, you know, I'm supposed to tell you this, but I really don't have to. I thought that was good. So, and then there's the not so sunny part of faith. It's testing of your faith through trials and tribulation. No one said it was going to be easy and smooth sailing and all sunshine and daisies. Unfortunately, there are bad parts. You will be questioned and persecuted for your faith, and that's unfortunate. And I think that being a kid growing up in school, I think it's getting harder these days to, you know, proclaim that you're a Christian in your school. And that's really a shame that people ask you, well, why? Why do you do that? Or, you know, like, if you get made fun of for being a Christian, I think that's a sad day in the world. But I think, there again, our youth group does a good job of being that light at our school, you know, and showing people, you know, it is okay to be a Christian, and it is a good thing, you know, and for spreading that light to other people. I was looking through the back of one of my Bibles, and it had the Beatitudes listed, and this one Beatitude stuck out to me. It said, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And that right there, that just gives me courage, you know, that it might get bad. Just look at one of the many disciples or Paul or anybody who's been in jail numerous times. But they can't take away your faith or your salvation. And you will find victory in Jesus every time. And I thought that made me feel good, though, to read that. And, you know, it might get bad a lot, but, you know, and if people make fun of me, I can always say, you know, mine is the kingdom of heaven. That's what I'm getting. This is my reward. And when I'm feeling discouraged about it, I like to think about the parable of the mustard seed. You know, it may seem like you're alone and you can't make a difference in the world. Like, why did I just, like, smile at this person? What is that going to do? But, you know, you never know when that's going to make a difference. And then, like me and my dad like to say, that you may be the only Bible someone gets to see. And you never know what that random act of kindness can do for somebody. And I'd like to read you one of my personal favorite Bible verses. It's Psalms 34:19. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. And I like that because it says to me, you know, you feel like it's hopeless. And you feel like you're taking one step forward and three steps back. But don't lose faith. It is going to get bad. I mean, I think we all know that. But no good deed goes unaccounted for. And that's what I like to stick to. Well, that was about all I had. But I think I set a new world record for the shortest sermon in the world. But, you know, to end, I would like to tell you a story about my own testimony of faith. So, bear with me. Well, on September 2nd, 2008, I'm sure all of you know my grandfather, Perry Green, passed away. And that was probably one of the worst days of my life. Well, it started off as another school day, just regular. You know, I was going on to school. You know, I always look at Grandma and Grandpa's house, wave if they're out there. You know, smile if they're not, but whatever. But I was in second period chemistry, not my favorite class. But then I got the loudspeaker came on. It said, "Can you please send Michelle Thomas to the office? She's checking out." I was like, did Mama schedule a dentist appointment? Did she just not tell me about it? Is this some kind of joke? Because she knows I need to be in second period chemistry. So, but then when I got out, I automatically knew. I remember the night before, my grandfather had gone to the doctor about having dizzy spells and about his heart. So I was like, this is not good. Something is wrong. So I ran as fast as I could down there and expecting to see Mama or Grandmama or Ashley. I saw Peggy Green and Miss Mary, and I was like, what in the world is going on? And Miss Mary just told me, it's okay, but they sent your father to the hospital by ambulance. So, of course, I'm like wigging out. I'm like, tell me what's going on. And I just felt uneasy the whole ride to Jacksonville Hospital. And then I remember getting out of the car, walking in the parking lot, and seeing my mother crying. And she told me he's gone. And I remember it felt like the world was crashing down around me. And my legs folded up under me, and I just sat in the parking lot and cried. And then I looked up, and I saw Grandmama. I think half the congregation was at the hospital, and I saw Grandmama. And she was hugging everybody and telling them, it's okay. He's okay. He's in a better place. And I thought, wow, you know, if I can have half of her faith, I will have done something with my life. If I can just have just a fourth or a half or just a fraction of her faith, that I will have done something with my life worthwhile. And she's been one of my biggest cheerleaders my whole life. And I just want to thank you for showing me that through the dark times of my life, that God's always with me and he's always there. So, but that's all I got. So, amen.
Teachers and the parents bringing your kids and all the different things, but throughout Bible school and the influence of this church and their families, these two have accepted Christ in different ways. Chandler came and accepted Christ by going to her parents, to her mom, and her mom prayed with her, and she accepted Christ into her heart. I talked about that, and she came down today to say that she wanted to let you know that she is a Christian and she wants to be a part of our church through baptism. All of you in favor of that, please say amen.
Amen.
All right. And Chloe happened to be out here running around the track, and it was hot, and I was out of shape, and I was dripping wet. But they were out here walking, she and her mom, and they said, we'd like to talk to you. And so we went into our church prayer room, and Mike probably had to have a mop when I got out of there. But it was a wonderful experience as we talked about Christ and her decision, the things she was feeling, and she went ahead and prayed and accepted Christ into her heart that day at our church prayer room. I'm very excited about that, Chloe. This is Chloe Boozer, and she's come to our church to tell you that she is a Christian and she wants to be a part of our church through baptism. If you're in favor of that, please say amen.
Amen.
Good. Well, we're proud to welcome y'all to you officially to Williams, your church, and we want to let you know that we're going to have baptism next Sunday night with these two and also Cameron Cochran. So we're really excited about that. And I hope that you will stand up here. Wendy, Brian, y'all may want to come stand with Chloe. If y'all want to come stand, Scott. And we'll let our congregation, after our benediction, come by and welcome y'all officially. They're going to hug you, give you some kisses probably, and shake your hand and tell you how glad they are that y'all are part of our church. Okay? All right. Welcome. Welcome. All right. I want to give the word to Michelle. Michelle and I are going to go back here. If you want to, you can come back here and give a little greeting to Michelle. I think preaching has a lot of components. Of course, the filling of the Spirit, which we talked about a lot in preparation for today. But I think it's also an art that you have that skill or you don't have that skill. And I think that Michelle did an incredible job today, which indicates to me that she has some skill.
Amen.
Not only just in speaking, but in speaking on behalf of her faith. And I'm really proud of the witness that she gave us. Your sermon was good, but the sermon of your life by standing up there was good too. Thank you very much for sharing what you shared today. I'm going to ask you to come back to that door with me as we have our benediction. Thank y'all for being here. Have a happy Father's Day.
Will you please bow your heads with us in a moment of prayer?
Dear Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here today and allowing us to be safe on our trip to Passport, and I just wanted to say, help us to get home safely today as we leave, and allowing us to be here today. Amen.
Amen.